If Apple squeezed a Mac Pro into a Mac Mini, you might end up with something like a Studio Mac. I mean, Mac Studio. I mean, M1, Mac Studio, Max. Studio Mac? No trash can, no cheese grater, just a single block of extruded aluminum with plenty of room for fans. And ports. They've got ports on the front, just like the Macs we used to love. Apple has gifted us two forward-facing USB-C ports and an SD card slot. For anyone who's been living in Johnny Ive's dongleverse for the past decade, this is a breath of fresh air. Remember all the ports that Macs used to have? Welcome back to the future. The back is decked out with four Thunderbolt 4 ports, Ethernet, USB-A, HDMI, and even a glorious headphone jack. The studio is just about 2.5 Mac Minis tall, but is dwarfed by Steve Jobs' stunning PowerMac G4 cube. Something tells us this cube won't have a convenient opening handle. Enough of the outside, time to figure out how to crack this thing open. Don't get stumped by that smooth exterior. Peeling up the foot ring reveals four friendly Torx screws. We're not in Mac Mini anymore, Toto. This black expanse is the underside of the power supply, not the antenna plate we've seen in Mini's past. A couple stubborn connectors later, we find out the studio really commits to this fashion statement. Apple's industrial design team covered the entire power supply in black tape and color-synchronized goop. This thing weighs a ton and is giving off some serious Darth Vader vibes. Our next victim, a super exciting frame that gets in the way of storage removal. Say what you will about the Trashcan Pro, at least it had immediately accessible upgrades. A single Torx screw and some isolation tape, and the internal storage is free. There's even a spare slot right here on the board. Time to find out if this modular storage is actually upgradable. After a lot of testing, some of it interrupted by Apple server issues, we actually have some definitive answers. We popped this stick into another base model Mac Studio's empty slot, but Configurator kept giving us DFU restore errors. No matter the configuration, we haven't gotten two base model drives to boot in a single machine. However, when we swapped the spare studio's drive for the one in the teardown unit and used Configurator to do a DFU restore, it worked. Storage swaps are possible, at least between drives of the same size. Jury's still out on upgrades, but we can always hope for a software update. From here, this layer cake is a bit of a puzzle. We're desperate to get at those modular-looking ports, but there's a lot of Tetris to take care of first. Brackets, connectors, oodles of Torx screws, even a Torx standoff. And we finally free the USB-A board, power connector, USB-C ports, and glorious SD card reader. With some more brackets and connectors sprinkled throughout. Whew! Dispatching more Torx screws, most of the antennas, and a heatsink bracket finally frees the logic board. This heatsink honestly takes our breath away. We should probably be more excited about the silicone, but look at this monster. It looks like the dual M1 is riding a little quadcopter. In the Ultra, that little chip is doubled. And thanks to Ultra Fusion architecture, the dual die looks and acts like a single ultra-fast 2.5 terabyte chip, an incredible feat of engineering. A feat we didn't spend the money on. That speed comes with a price. The RAM is built in, so upgrade at purchase or forever hold your peace. Back to the quadcopter. It's actually a massive heatsink and two fans. Well, a dual fan assembly anyway. This impressive array manages the heat created by the M1 Max, and judging by rave reviews, they're doing a good job. Oh, and there's an antenna in here, just for fun. These fans are just so much more massive than other Mac fans, and the heatsink positively dwarfs the M1 Mini with more than 6 times the weight. The ultra-powered studio is even beefier with a copper heatsink that's a whopping 2 pounds heavier than the aluminum one in our Mac studio. Let's hope this system likes dust. It's gonna be a heck of a chore to clean these out every couple years. Then again, without upgradable storage, maybe the studio won't stay relevant long enough to get dusty. There's a depressing thought. One more thing. We couldn't resist tearing into the studio display that reviewers are ripping to shreds. We're excited to find out how much of a computer this screen is. Turns out, it slices like an iMac, opens like an iMac, and looks a lot like an iMac. We can't wait to dig in. The power supplies are crazy thin, and the fans surprisingly hefty. But what's up with that webcam? It peels up fairly easily and is definitely a match for the iPhone 11. But webcams rely so much on software that we can't say anything definitive quality-wise. Let's hope for an update. But more on this display later. Much more. We love that Apple had the courage to beef up their desktop, allowing for awesomely modular ports and a hefty heat management system. But the Mac Studio falls short thanks to odd choices like buried fans and non-upgradable storage. Not to mention baked-in RAM. All told, the Mac Studio nets a 6 out of 10 on our repairability scale. The Mac Studio is a worthy successor to the Mac Mini, but it isn't quite ready for the pros. That said, it gives us a lot of hope for a repairable, upgradable, and reasonably priced Mac Pro. Maybe without a cheese grater this time.